of the nut is, tell me,
Superman.
And what are Superman's powers?
Strength and flying.
Strength and flying.
You can leap tall buildings with a single bound.
There you go.
Hey, your superpower is forgetting to turn your mic on.
I did turn my mic on.
It's dead.
No, it's not.
Is it dead?
No.
It lives!
Superman the rescue.
Super Stop Crew.
Who's our next one?
Spider-Man.
Okay, what's Spider-Man's superpower?
Spider-Man.
What's our next one?
Captain America.
What have we got for Captain America?
Strength, and he never dies.
He never dies. I think it's all fiction making, but that's all right. What do they have in common? Yes, they're superheroes. I got that part. What else?
They help people.
They're invincible. They do good. Now, I'm going to give you the Wikipedia definition of superheroes this. A superhero is a type of heroic stock character, usually possessing supernatural and superhuman powers, who is dedicated to fighting the evil of their universe, protecting the public, and usually battling the supervillains. Now, as children, we would dream of being that superhero out to get the bad guys, and feeling a sense of victory as we defeated our foe. Imagination is fun. As is in most comics and movies that feature superheroes, the good guy always wins. We enjoy being entertained by these characters and love the
to be no hope.
I'm pretty sure these characters are not going to show up in our lives to rescue us from the struggles of daily life. But I am here to tell you that there are real-life superheroes. Let's read the biblical story of a superhero found in 1 Samuel chapter 17. And I know that this is pretty lengthy, and so we do have the words along. Sometimes it's easier to grasp the whole story. This is the story of David and Goliath. The Philistines now mustered their army for battle and camped between Soko in Judah and Azekah in Ephes-Damim. Saul countered with the buildup of forces at Elah Valley. So the Philistines and Israelis forced each other on opposite hills with the valley between them. Then Goliath, the Philistine champion from Gath, came out of the Philistine ranks to face the forces of Israel. He was a giant of a man, measuring over 9 feet tall. He wore a bronze helmet, a 200-pound coat of mail, bronze leggings, and carried a bronze javelin several inches thick, with a 25-pound iron spearhead, and his armor-bearer walked ahead of him with a huge shield. He stood and shouted across to the Israelis, "Do you need a whole army to settle this? I will represent the Philistines, and you choose someone to represent you, and we will settle this in single combat. If your man is able to kill me, then we will be your slaves. But if I kill him, then you must be our slaves. I defy the armies of Israel. Send me a man who will fight with me." When Saul and the Israeli army heard this, they were dismayed and frightened. David, the son of aging Jesse, a member of the tribe of Judah who lived in Bethlehem, had 7 older brothers. The 3 oldest, Eliab, Abinadab, and Shammah, had already volunteered for Saul's army to fight the Philistines. David was the youngest son and was on Saul's staff on a part-time basis. He went back and forth to Bethlehem to help his father with the sheep. For 40 days, twice a day, morning and evening, the Philistine giant strutted before the armies of Israel. One day, Jesse said to David, "Take this bushel of roasted grain and these 10 loaves of bread to your brothers. Give this cheese to their captain and see how the boys are getting along, and bring us back a letter from them." Saul and the Israeli army were camped at the valley of Elah. So David left the sheep with another shepherd and took off early the next morning with the gifts. He arrived at the outskirts of the camp, just as the Israeli army was leaving for the battlefield with shouts and battle cries. Soon the Israeli and Philistine forces stood facing each other, army against army. David left his luggage with the baggage officer and hurried out to the ranks to find his brothers. As he was talking with them, he saw Goliath, the giant, step out from the Philistine troops and shout his challenge to the army of Israel. As soon as they saw him, the Israeli army began to run away in fright. "Have you seen the giant?" the soldiers were asking. "He has insulted the entire army of Israel, and have you heard about the huge reward the king has offered to anyone who kills him? And the king will give him one of his daughters for a wife, and his whole family will be exempted from paying taxes." David talked to some others standing there to verify the report. "What will a man get for killing this Philistine and ending his insults to Israel?" he asked them. "Who is this heathen Philistine anyway? What he is allowed to defy the armies of the living God?" And he received the same reply as before. But when David's older brother, Goliath, heard David talking like that, he was angry. "What are you doing around here anyway?" he demanded. "What about the sheep you're supposed to be taking care of? I know what a cocky brat you are. You must want to see the battle." "What have I done now?" replied David. "I was only asking a question." And he walked over to some others and asked them the same thing and received the same answer. When it was finally realized what David meant, someone told King Saul, and the king sent for him. "Don't worry about a thing," David told them. "I'll take care of this Philistine." "Don't be ridiculous," Saul replied. "How can a kid like you fight with a man like him? You are only a boy, and he's been in the army since he was a boy." But David persisted. "When I am taking care of my father's sheep," he said, "a lion or a bear comes and grabs a lamb from the flock. I go after it with the club and take the lamb from its mouth. If it turns on me, I catch it by the jaw and club it to death. I have done this to both lions and bears, and I'll do it to this heathen Philistine here, too, for he has defied the armies of the living God. The Lord who saved me from the claws and teeth of the lion and the bear will save me from this Philistine. Paul finally consented. All right, go ahead, he said, and may the Lord be with you. Then Saul gave David his own armor, a bronze helmet, and a coat of mail. David put it on, strapped the sword over it, and took a step or two to see what it was like, for he had never worn such things before. I can hardly move, he exclaimed, and took them off again. Then he picked up 5 smooth stones from a stream and put them in his shepherd's bag, and armed only with his shepherd's staff and a sling, started across to Goliath. Goliath walked out toward David with his shield bearer ahead of him, sneering in contempt at this nice little red-cheeked boy. Am I a dog, he roared at David, that you come at me with a stick? And he cursed David by the names of his gods. Come over here and I'll give your flesh to the birds and wild animals, Goliath yelled. David shouted in reply. You come to me with a sword and a spear, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of the armies of heaven and of Israel, the very God whom you have defied. Today, the Lord will conquer you, and I will kill you and cut off your head, and then I will give the dead bodies of your men to the birds and wild animals, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel, and Israel will learn that the Lord does not depend on weapons to fulfill his plans. He works without regard to human means. He will give you to us. As Goliath approached, David ran out to meet him, reaching into his shepherd bag, took out a stone, hurled it from his sling, and hit the Philistine in the forehead. The stone sank in, and the man fell on his face to the ground. So David conquered the Philistine giant with a sling and a stone. Since he had no sword, he ran over and pulled Goliath from its sheath and killed him with it, and then cut off his head. When the Philistines saw that their champion was dead, they turned and ran away. Then the Israelis gave a great shout of triumph and rushed after the Philistines, chasing them as far as Gath and the gates of Ephraim. The bodies of the dead and wounded Philistines were strewn all along the road to Shaaraim. When the Israeli army returned and plundered the deserted Philistine camp. Later, David took Goliath's head to Jerusalem and restored his armor in his tent. As Saul was watching David go out to fight Goliath, he asked Abner, the general of his army, Abner, what sort of family does this young fellow come from? I really don't know, Abner said. We'll find out, the king told him. After David had killed Goliath, Abner brought him to Saul with the Philistine's head still in his hand. Tell me about your father, my boy, Saul said. And David replied, his name is Jesse, and we live in Bethlehem. Here ends the Old Testament lesson. The reason I think that this scripture from beginning to end is so important is because David, as a young boy, conquered something bigger than he could ever imagine. And then later went on to become a great king. Now, I'm not to say that we're going to become great kings, but a small boy with trust is able to do just that. David is a superhero. David saw the problem of overwhelming impossibility. He met the villain, Goliath, and then he heard God reassure him that he was capable of this challenge and trusted God to walk with him into battle. David's bravery and trust in God allowed him to defeat the giant and helps us see that even the least likely people can conquer the giants of life. The Israelites were so afraid of the Philistines, but God had a big plan. The least likely person would become the superhero while the unbeatable giant was defeated. I long to have the bravery and complete trust that David had as he faced Goliath. Again, from the same scripture, David shouted in reply, you come to me with a sword and a spear, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of the armies of heaven and of Israel, the very God whom you have defied. He knew that he was called to fight this battle and entered into it without fear. Goliath appeared to most of the Israelites to be invincible, unable to be defeated, but they were wrong. David knew that without God on his side and trusting his heart, he could conquer this giant. Now, with all of this talk of superheroes and villains, you may be wondering what the takeaway of this message could possibly have to do with our everyday life. The truth is this. We are all superheroes. We don't face Goliath, the Joker, or the Penguin, or Magneto as our villains. We face villains of the world that struggles with loneliness, hunger, depression, anger, grief, homelessness, fear, anxiety, the elements of nature, bullying, self-worth. This list is just a snapshot of the evils in the world. As we recognize these evils in the life of others, we have the opportunity, the blessing of being a superhero to those in need. Be a superhero to someone who is lonely by your offering to spend time with them. Someone who struggles with fear could use a superhero that offers them reassurance and comfort. Our church is a superhero to some that are hungry by providing the items for the blessing boxes. A child that feels bullied could use a superhero that helps him realize his worth and offer him hope. The life of a hero does not expect anything in return. It only serves to make the world a better place. While fictional superheroes have individual and unique strengths, we as everyday heroes share a common strength. The ability to love unconditionally, expecting nothing in return. What about villains in our own lives? There is someone willing to be the David to your Goliath. So don't be afraid to ask God to send your David to you when you're in need. You don't have to be your own superhero, but you do have to accept the superheroes that God places in your life if you want to get rid of that villain. Being a superhero, it really just takes awareness, care, compassion, and a whole lot of our superhero needs. I want to close with a video that sums up this whole idea of being a hero. A superhero. We all have these special powers. Let's see the amazing ways we can slay the villains and evils that surround us. We can put on our armor and overcome with love.
Fire! Let your fire fall. Thank you, praise God, for the wonderful music. Thank you, Trish, for the uplifting and powerful message. And thank you all who made this worship possible today. I pray you all go from here in peace, having a restful Sabbath, and safety, because it's not looking too great out there. Until you can see each other again, take this blessing with you. The Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you. May God give you peace. Amen.